Thank you for coming to this room all the way to the other side of the building. And I'm really, really pleased to be in Stockholm and on the conference today. And for me, also the first time in Sweden. So really happy to be here. We're going to talk today about the 12 ingredients of the pizza organization. Now, anybody who expects to get pizza afterwards, I have to disappoint, but you will get some tasty pictures left and right. Maybe a short introduction about myself. I'm an HR and organization innovator, and I support especially HR teams, but not only, to create the organization of the future. And today we heard a lot of about purpose and what makes people tick. And my purpose is to make sure that we create workplaces more meaningful, more about people. And in Dutch, we would say a little bit mooier. It means a little bit more beautiful in the sense of that we really get up in the morning and think, really want to go to work because it's a great place to be. So that's, I think, a nice purpose. And I'm celebrating this year that I'm doing this for since 10 years now. And you can imagine that 10 years ago, we were in the middle of a crisis. And a lot of these themes that we heard today were not very high on the agenda. So I came from a corporate background, and I was really enthusiastic to change the world with all my dreams. And I was standing in front of an audience, I remember about 100 HR people, and I was asking, who really sees that we need to change things, that we need to organize work in a different way? And there was maybe 5 people who raised their hand, like, yeah, we have this topic on the agenda. So I was like, oh, this is going to be a very hard talk, you know, if I... But a lot of things changed in the meantime. So now we are fast forwarding 10 years. And if I would ask now, well, especially in this conference, everybody has this on the agenda, otherwise you wouldn't be here. But if I asking an HR audience, is, you know, the transformation, is this on your agenda? Are you thinking about the agility and what it's the employee experience to put that in the on your agenda? It's like only 5 people will not put up their hand. So there's a big change going on. And I honestly think it's a great time to be in HR. Having said that, I also think that in the future we do not have such a thing as an HR department anymore, because I believe in HR and people-related roles. So we're going to talk about agility in organizations today. So I'm leaving the HR bit a little bit out, more about the organizational part of the story. Quick question to yourself. Don't have to answer out loud, but just for yourself. If you would score your own organization or the organizations you work with, on a scale 0 to 5, how agile is that organization? And never mind the definition of agile, because of course that's very that can vary. But just for yourself, are you in the beginning or already a very agile organization? But that's very broad. So if you narrow it down a little bit, if you would bring it to your department, how agile is your department? And is your department more or less agile than the organization? Are you the one taking the lead and starting the fire? Or are you lacking behind a bit and the rest of the organization is already getting very agile? And then, of course, if you narrow it down a little bit further, how agile are you? And we heard that before on stage today as well. You know, the change starts with yourself. So having said that, in these 3 layers, I also would like to briefly go through the 12 ingredients of the agile organization. And not in detail, but just that you know in the back of your mind, these ingredients can apply to the whole organization. And these ingredients can apply to my department. And how would I relate to these ingredients? And the ingredients are not going to be completely new for you, because a lot of the ingredients I heard already today, but it will help you to keep everything together. And this is how I started with this framework in the first place, because I saw so many things happening and so many things changing that I didn't know anymore where to start. So I said, okay, let's put it in a framework, so at least I can go through it step by step and see how that works. One other question for you. In this survey from last year, Deloitte asked senior executives how agile or agility and collaboration is a high priority. And they asked this to the senior executives. And the second question was, and our organization is highly agile today. Do you have any idea on the first remark how much the percentage of people said, yes, it's on our agenda? A shout out? 80? Close, even a little bit higher, or quite higher. Oh, it's not working now. Well, you have to believe me. If I do need my clicker if it's now stalled. I have no connection at all anymore. You see, that's why I always have paperwork with me. My computer froze. It's not gonna move the whole presentation. Hang on one sec. Just gonna start that slide again and hope it's not the slide. So I have a micro connector. Never do that with your computer. Okay, let's give it a go and see. We're back. So 94%. So, and I must say they were quite honest. What about the answer on the second one? Our organization is highly agile today. Any idea how high the percentage was? Did you read the reason? 6%. And it's a coincidence that adds up to 100. There's no relation to that. So there's a lot of work still to do. And in a way, it's also a comfort to know that if you are in the beginning of this journey, like you're not the only one. There's a lot of people still, a lot of organizations still with a lot of work to do. And I did a research 2 years ago, and I asked more or less the same question. And mind you, on the left-hand side is the traditional pyramid hierarchical organization, and to the right-hand side is what I call an agile organization. It's all connected teams. And I also found that about only 6% of my respondents, but it was a pilot, it was a smaller group, said, well, we are really agile today. And most of them are still in the traditional corner. So that about numbers. So this is where my way of thinking comes from, is from the left-hand side, we are from the traditional, the pyramid. And for me, what is interesting here is that we say, here is where the magic happens, in the department. If we're all sitting with finance people together, this is where we add our value. And we heard today a few times that we have to flip that perspective. We are not adding value necessarily in the HR department, or in the finance department, or in the planning department. We have to reorganize our work, and I call it a plate where you put the pizza on, and the plate is your activity. And that's where the magic happens. And that's where you organize your roles, not functions, roles that are necessary to accomplish that activity. And that's where the magic happens. So it's where here we sit with all HR people, for example, together. In the pizza organization, we sit together in a kind of community of practice where we learn from other HR colleagues. But where we actually add our value is over here. So that's it. Keep that in the back of your mind if we go to the rest of the ingredients. So why pizza? Could have chosen something else. I'm very much inspired by Josephine Green, who writes about pancakes. But then pancakes were a bit difficult to make nicely in like the rolls. And then I must admit, I'm married to a Sicilian, so that helped a little bit in understanding how he cooks, because we found out about 30 years ago that I cannot cook as well as his mother. And that from that day on, I said, well, you do the cooking then. But I had a lot of time to watch him cook and especially prepare pizza. And there were a few lessons that I learned, important lessons that you can translate to the transition to an agile organization. You fail, you learn. That's the first thing. Always use good ingredients and take your time. Don't try to, you know, buy a frozen pizza bottom somewhere and then put it in a microwave. You do need your time and you do need good ingredients. You can't just leave one out. I think in all the talks that I heard today, this was already confirmed, that if you start working on a certain area, it will have an effect on another area, and you cannot ignore that area. Or you cannot just say, okay, let's leave out that area. It will come back to you. It will haunt you if you don't pay attention to that. Make sure the oven is at the right temperature. Sometimes maybe you want to move too fast in the transition. And you know, if your oven is too hot, that doesn't really help. It's too crisp. If it's not warm enough, you get some floppy thing that you can't eat. And there's no such thing as the best recipe. And I heard that a few times today as well. And this is also my framework, or the pizza framework, is not about the best recipe. It's about just making sure that you will use all 12 ingredients. Is there anybody from Naples in the room? Good, that saves a discussion. So about this recipe, and you can't read this, but don't worry about that. But just on this side are the 12 ingredients from the pizza. This is where we are maybe right now in the pyramid paradigm. So my message to you today is use all 12 ingredients, see where you are. Yes, we are moving to this direction, and it will help you to determine where to start. Because if we have good scores already here, maybe it's an idea to start with the lower scores and start at this side of the organization. So that's basically what I mean with there is not such a thing as a best recipe. It depends on your context, it depends on your culture, it depends on your company phase, and it also depends on your courage. Which steps do you dare to make? So zooming in, I will keep this quite briefly because you will recognize a lot of the ingredients. But zooming in on 12 ingredients, there are also four agility themes. So the top one, and there is no order in this, it's just that I had something on to put something on the top, the only order in the framework is these are maybe the more obvious ones and the more visible ones. And it's difficult to say if there's a lot of IT Scrum people here that I say the easier. This is about Scrum. This is about Kanban. How many IT Scrum people do I have here? Okay, I'll stay on this side. No, it's not, because it's not easy to really implement Scrum. And this is not where the whole framework started for me. I only discovered Scrum, Kanban, and so on about 5 years ago. And about 10 years ago, I was thinking, how can we make organizations more agile? So I started from a completely different angle. But now these two worlds are meeting. So the IT Scrum world, let's call it that way to keep it simple, and the whole transformation from leadership and culture, they are meeting. And this is why I think we have such a great time right now. So we have the agile ways of working, and this is about adjusting along the way to divide work in small steps, in iterations, with short feedback loops. This is about psychological safety, and this is about getting the room to experiment. If you do that, then you will find out that your structure, that there's getting clots in the dough, I call that. You know, if you have a pizza dough, you're kneading it, but you still have some lumps or clots in it, you really need to knead them out. Because your structure will clash with that. As you saw in that picture earlier on, you saw the pyramid. And then if you want to work with multidisciplinary teams, then it's going to clash. Because this multidisciplinary team is where you have your, let's say it's about employer branding. You have your HR, your recruitment, your communication, your hiring manager, somebody from the team. And then finance gets nuts because there's all these people from different departments and the budget is not budget like that. Team leader is going crazy because people are suddenly working in this, these kind of teams. So there's a lot of friction coming up. And if you start working in these kind of teams and they are self-organizing and they need to respond fast, they also need different ways of decision making. And not only that, you also are looking at the concept of contextual leadership. On the panel discussion, we heard about manager. Well, what is management? And it's like a tool and you can use it. This is exactly what contextual leadership is about. It's also, it's depending on the context, somebody else will take the lead. The most logical, the most obvious one will take the lead. But you don't only have to change your structure, you also have to look into your infrastructure. And this is all about transparency and making sure that everybody gets the information that he or she needs in order to respond fast. And this is many times obstructed by politics or by all kind of fear to say, I'm not going to share my piece of the puzzle. But that means you're obstructing the agility of the organization. And if you think about the flock of starlings that Alice was showing this morning, you know, that they fly so fluently. Can you imagine somebody, one of the starlings saying like, hey, I'm not going to participate in this. I'm going to keep my piece of the information. Then, you know, you will have some collisions. So, but this is already more difficult to change. And then we go to a deeper level, and this is getting harder and harder because here we're talking about leadership. This is about leadership saying, I trust that you can do the job. I trust, I will give you space because I trust that you team can do the job. And you can take your own decisions. And if I am too tight in command and control and I'm working with KPIs, this will not work. Because if I have a sub KPI here instead of an overall purpose or an overall goal, then this team will never fly because it will, you know, I will be in it for my HR KPI and the other for marketing KPI. So you have to make sure that you have a common purpose and common targets or outcomes. We love to work in outcomes in these, and it ties in very nicely with the OKR part of it. But it's also about inclusion. If you're constantly working in these kind of pizza teams and you constantly have to regroup and perform, there is no room for politics, for ego, for playing games, not opening up to others. You really have to make sure that it's a smooth transition, like there is a mini onboarding every time you start a new team. And the leadership needs to set the example here. And this one, this is where the whole story started for me, like 15 years ago, when I was working for a corporate company, and we had a great employee engagement survey scores. But I was like, it should be much higher. Why isn't this working better? And then I said, let's flip the perspective and let's make the person, the individual, leading in how we create and how we design our HR practices. And this ties in very nicely if you say we are working with empowered teams, with people with talent, they bring that to the table or they bring it to the pizza plate. Then you also need to reinvent your whole HR practices and you have to align it with it if you really want to put this person and empower this person. And then the last one, because this is all great and imagine you're doing this, which one is missing here is the shared purpose and relevance. Because you can do all these things, but if nobody is waiting for what you're doing, what you're producing, and there's no relevance for it, then why bother in the first place? And if it's not clear to me as an employee what that purpose is, how can I make my own decisions within those pizza teams if I'm not sure what my direction is. So you really need to have a clear shared purpose. And only if you add up all these things, I talk about culture and agile mindset. So this is to keep everything together. So there's no hierarchy. Sorry, was that too quickly? No, you're okay? No hierarchy or order. There's crisscross relations. And that's to give you an example. I see three common recipes. So I move to, for example, in this score here, we see an organization that scores very high on the agile ways of working. So imagine scrum teams. And they embrace a lot of experimenting. But from here, they start to feel the friction with the structure. In the second situation, we have leadership that says, okay, we really see that we have to change. We are living in a different era, and the way we did it is not good anymore. We really have to start looking into different ways of organizing work. A big danger there is that it feels very top-down, that suddenly leadership put agility on the agenda. Now we all have to do that. And the third one is working in autonomous teams. I don't know here in Sweden, but I think it's more or less the same as in Holland. Like, it's really hip also to do it. Like, let's do autonomous teams so everybody can do self-organization. And then what they do, they take the department heads, and then I'll say they eliminate them. Yeah, I'll say they chop off all the heads, literally. And they send them home, and then suddenly the team, the department has to do more work. And the layer above has to do more work as well, because they just, you know, it was a cost-saving thing. But this working in autonomous teams, if you do that in a multidisciplinary team and you really empower them, it's a different story. But it's difficult, because then you're here as an empowered team. You need different way of decision-making. You need good infrastructure. And you need space and trust from your leadership, so you can do your own thing. And not if things go a little bit bad, they step in immediately. So if you see these three, these for me are three starting points that I see a lot in practice. And so such a scan could help, just to say, okay, where am I? What do I need to do next? And in this example, what I said, they're doing quite good on Scrum. They have difficulties on you know, the continuous dialogue and giving each other feedback how things are going. So there could be some improvement there. But you see that they are organized quite traditionally. And this will cause friction, because they can't move as fast as they should with the changes going on. So in this case, this is how it would look. I have handouts for you, so you can read it that part back. This is how the recipe for this certain circumstance could be. So my advice is then, you know, if you start working with Agile and you go through all the ingredients, you will find a friction. Don't leave out that ingredient, but knead out, you know, massage out the problems. And go and find your own best recipe. Add love, courage, and fun to your own taste. How am I doing on time? Okay, so I'll stop here right now. Thank you.